Welcome to Second Edition. I'm Thomas Doucette, joined by Sarah Gouda. Today we take a look at how a local junior hockey organization is relaunching amid rising COVID cases in Edmonton.
Plus, like it or not, winter is coming. We will take you through the best tips for keeping yourself and your garden in tip-top shape for the upcoming winter.
And the Edmonton Oilers have had a busy off-season. We speak with Jason Greger to talk about the new additions. No Stone Left Alone will be commemorating its 10th anniversary via live stream hosted in Edmonton's Beechmount Cemetery tomorrow.
We didn't expect it to look quite like this, but we're really just grateful that we're able to continue with commemorations in one way or another.
The organization normally brings thousands of children across the country to military memorials to place poppies in the graves of Canadian service members. Even through live streaming, bringing children closer to these veterans is still the top priority.
That's just the most important part, because only by making that connection can they carry that with them. And then, you know, we kind of pass the torch of remembrance.
You can find their ceremonies and their Facebook page at nostoneleftalone.ca. The live stream begins tomorrow at 10:30 a.m.
The Nest reopening may take longer than NATESA first anticipated. It is confirmed that the Nest will remain closed. The Nest staff were excited to reopen this season. However, all members of the Nest bar have been laid off. The reopening has been postponed until fall of next year. Nest manager Michelle Dirksen explains why this is the most responsible and safe course of action for staff and guests.
At this time of uncertainty with variable costs and external factors, we deemed that there were too many challenges and risks that we could not control while maximizing our potential for profitability.
The Nest hopes to reopen in the fall of next year. When they do, they will have a new name. They're changing it to The Nest Eatery.
With most ACAC sports on the shelf until at least January, alternatives have been sought out to keep interconference competition alive. The ACAC has paired up with a new organization on a trial basis to bring competitive collegiate esports to our province. The Alberta Esports Association will be hosting a Super Smash Bros. Ultimate event, and co-founder Victor Lee explains why.
Concordia University and NATE, as two examples, have existing esports clubs, particularly for the Smash titles, which is by far the province's most popular game, just historically speaking.
The event is scheduled to take place November 21st.
The TYP Top Bakery was initiated by Trinity Youth Project Manager Clark Hardy. It is located in the Anglican Church. This bakery provides job opportunities for struggling youth. The bakery operates in the kitchen and offers a flexible schedule and positions, such as volunteering or paid employment. Although run from a church, the bakery has had its success with sold-out orders on consecutive days. Clark Hardy explains his plans moving forward.
We would love to get to the point where we're a sustainable business, operating full-time, and with that, able to offer full-time employment and part-time employment for our youth on an ongoing basis.
If you're from 18 to 25 and would like to volunteer, you can check out their website at edmonton.anglican.ca. You can also order baked goods online.
The arrival of fall means the start of the Capital Junior Hockey League season, but COVID-19 restrictions are drastically changing the way that they play.
Our Michael Yurchak caught up with a head coach in the league to dive deeper into the effects of these restrictions.
Hello, my name is Michael Yurchak. I'm here with Mike Fagan, the head coach of the St. Albert Merchants. How are you doing, Mike?
Good. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. Appreciate you taking time out of your day to do this interview. So my first question for you is, how has the Capital Junior Hockey League season been affected by COVID-19? So like, what are some new restrictions being implemented?
Yeah, so basically we had a late start to the season. We are required to be put in pods, so we can only play one team for four games over 2 weeks, then we have to quarantine for 2 weeks. So had a bit of a delay to the season, which affected things, and got the ball rolling now.
Nice. All right. So how have your staff and players reacted to these new restrictions?
Obviously, with COVID, there's a lot of restrictions. We have to fill out the templates every, or these forms every practice and game. We have to make sure nobody has symptoms because we don't want to get anybody else sick. So even if you had a mild cough or a runny nose, we have to take further requirements for you not to come to practice and keep the team safe.
Awesome. All right. So as a coach, how have you had to work around these restrictions to find success?
Yeah, it's a lot different than most years, especially with COVID this year. We've had to really dial in our players. Everybody's health conditions is obviously number one. So with coming to practice, we've had to work around these by some players might not be able to make practice. They might be in quarantine. So we have to play it by the safest bet at all times.
All right. Awesome. So are there any like new positives that have come out of COVID that you didn't think were possible before?
Yeah. So with having to quarantine for 2 weeks after we play four games against the same team, we have a lot of more time for team bonding, more volunteer work, be a better spotlight in our community. So it lets us help out that way.
Awesome. All right. So my last question for you is, what is the biggest thing you miss about regular Capital Junior Hockey League?
Oh, I think it's just the regular schedule, being able to play different teams, right? It gets a little frustrating playing the same team 2 weeks in a row, four times, but just having a regular season, having your home games, having your away games, being able to have fans, at the games. So just more like the atmosphere and yeah. That's about it.
All right. Well, appreciate you taking your time, Mike, to do this interview. So thank you so much. My name is Michael Yurchek, part of Second Edition.
NHL free agency opened up this October, and Oilers general manager Ken Holland has been busy trying to bolster the Oilers lineup.
Austin Levine caught up with TSN 1260's Jason Greger to talk about the signings of Kyle Turris and Tyson Barrie.
I just want to say thank you so much for giving me your time. I really appreciate you doing this interview with me.
No problem.
So what do you think would be reasonable expectations for Tyson Barrie point-wise? Like, what do you think would be underperforming if he didn't get to a certain point, or?
Well, Tyson Barrie's a guy who's scored 50 points numerous times, and he's going to jump in on the best power play in the league, and he might make it better because he's a right shot. So
yeah.
The power play, the thing is, though, he's playing defense. It still runs through McDavid, Drysdale, Nugent, Hopkins. I don't think that's going to change because of Barrie. I think he'll just complement it well.
Yeah.
So I look at his point totals, and what I think people kind of forget what happened when they changed their coach in Toronto and Keith came in. All of a sudden, Tyson Barrie's production was kind of similar to years past. He had 31 points in 47 games. Yeah. So if I think it's going to be a 48-game season, I think Tyson Barrie can score you, anywhere from 32 to 35 points if he stays healthy.
Do you think he's better defensively than he gets credit for?
I don't think he's as bad as some people are saying. I don't think he's a tire fire in his own zone, but that's not his forte. I'm not expecting Tyson Barrie to be a lockdown, shutdown defenseman. He engages in the play. He jumps up in the rush better than any other order defenseman. And, by doing that, then hopefully they spend less time in their own zone.
So then I'm just going to switch to Kyle Turris on you. So he was brought in for providing secondary scoring. Do you see him also taking on more of a defensive role?
Never really been a defensive guy. What they're going to look at, the way the NHL is now, your third line, you hope to chip in some offense. And I think that's what they're going to expect from Kyle Turris. He didn't get a ton of defensive zone starts in Nashville. He really hasn't been a regular penalty killer probably since 2013 or 14. So, maybe he gets a little bit of PK time,
yeah,
depending. But, realistically, I think they want him to be a guy who can outscore the opposition's other bottom six forwards, whoever they are. Because usually in today's NHL now, your big gunners, your top two lines play against the other team's top two lines more often than not. Every now and then, there's like a Radek Faxa in Dallas who's so good that they'll match him up against another team's top six. But most times, it's McDavid and Drysdale will go up against McKinnon line and,
yeah,
the Kadri line, and that's kind of how it is. And then it's up to Turris's line to be able to tread water or potentially outscore the other team's bottom six. And I think that's what they're going to look for. They're going to look for him and Puljujarvi to start together, I would think.
Yeah.
Maybe Josh Archibald plays the left side on there. Maybe James Neal does. But I think they'll look for that line to have a little bit more offensive punch than they had last year in the third line.
Thanks a lot, Jason Greger. I'm Austin Levine, Second Edition News.
After the break, we're joined by the rest of the Second Edition team.
From gardening to fitness, we tell you how to get prepared for the cold months ahead.
You're watching Nate News Watch, the next generation of news.
Second edition, where we will take a look at the heart-pounding action behind horror films and how you can stay fit in the comfort of your own home.
But first, we're joined by our own Gabe Muncaster as they tell us how to get your garden ready for the snow.
Holy smokes, is it ever cold up? Oh, hey, I didn't see you there. Please, excuse the weird, breathy introduction. It's just that it's November now and it's absolutely gosh darn freezing outside. I'm sure you have a garden, I have a garden, you have a garden, I've seen it. Very nice, good job. But some of us worry about our gardens in the winter, and we should. Gardens need to be taken care of just as much as we need to be taken care of in the winter, so you're gonna need to be doing some winterization prep, which is why I'm here. My name is Gabriel Muncaster, this is Second Edition, and let's break down some garden winterization. So step one, you're gonna wanna take any sort of detritus that you got on the top there, and you're gonna wanna scrape it off using whatever you have handy. Step two, you're gonna wanna get in there and you're gonna wanna take out anything that's still alive, that's still big. So I got this beautiful green onion here. You're gonna wanna get in and you're gonna dig out the white part, and look at that baby, she's beautiful. You just wanna give her a little kiss. Just a little, amazing. So step three, you're gonna wanna go in on your hands and knees and you're gonna wanna pluck out everything else that is rooted to the ground and that's covering the top, especially if it looks like it's still alive. I know we don't like killing plants, but the problem is that in the first couple snows and the melts in the snows and the melts in the snows is you can get some rot in there, which can mess up the pH of your soil. It can hurt the bugs, and we love the bugs, and it can just lead to a very nasty start to your spring. So you're gonna wanna just take them out. You don't have to be perfect, but you wanna have most of your soil visible. All right, step four, the sunflowers. Now, if you're like me, and you've waited to winterize your garden until the very last day of the growing season, which was about 4 weeks ago, you're going to want to have a tool handy. So now that you got your tool, and I'm sure you do, just start hacking and slashing away. Those sunflowers won't even know what hit them. All right, step five. Now, this is arguably the most important step, and here's a fun little tidbit for those of you with sunflowers. You're gonna take all those leaves that are on those pesky stems that you just chopped down, and you're gonna rip them off. And then you're gonna take the stems off of the leaves so you just have the dried leaf left, and you're gonna take them as a big old pile and sprinkle them all over your garden like a big old bag of banana seeds. If you have a lot of sunflowers, I didn't, but if you do, it'll probably cover most of it. And if you don't, or you just don't have sunflowers in general, you're gonna wanna go in any direction, like 3 feet from you, and just grab a big old pile of fallen leaves. Steal your neighbors. Why not? So yeah, now your garden's winterized. No need to thank me, please. Holy applause, holy, stop. My name is Gabe Muncaster. Thank you for watching my segment. This is Second Edition.
You're watching Nate News Watch, the next generation of news.
Hey everyone, I'm Cassidy Shandrow, and I'm currently a student athlete playing for the Nate Women's Hockey Team. As a student athlete, I know how important workouts are for me, and I'm sure they're important for many people who aren't student athletes as well. But with COVID going on and everything, I know how scary it is to go to the gym and stuff like that. So I'm here to show you how to get a good workout in at home using absolutely no equipment, because I know a lot of people don't have the kind of equipment needed at their own house. So here we go. So the first exercise I'm going to be showing you guys today is kind of like a normal plank, but with a bit of a twist. So you're going to get into the formation of a normal plank, but then you're going to go into a side plank, and instead of just holding it like this, you're gonna lift one arm up and lift one leg, and you're gonna bring them together like this. And you're gonna do probably about, I would say if you want a number of reps, I would say 15, or if you're doing seconds, I would say do 30 seconds. And just do that probably in a set of three. For the second exercise, it's kind of just like a V-sit, but you're gonna lay all the way down with your back on the floor. You're gonna lay your legs out and hover them above the ground and put your arms straight above your head, and you're gonna lift your legs up and you're just gonna go like this. And you're gonna lift your upper body up and touch your toes. And for that one, if you want reps, again, I'd probably say
30 reps. And if you're doing seconds, if you base your workouts off of seconds, I'd say probably do that for 30 to 45 seconds, a minute if you really want to. And again, just do this in a set of three, and you can alternate the three exercises that I'm going to be showing you today. For the third exercise I'm going to be showing you today, it's going to be a modification of a plank walk. So you're going to go into your normal plank like this. So I'm going to start probably over this way, just so I have more room that way. And you're going to step one foot out and step your hand, put the other hand in, put the other foot in. And when you get back to this position, you're going to do a push-up, and then you're going to do the same thing, and then do a push-up, and you're going to do three one way and three the other way. And every time you stop, you're just going to go and you're going to do a push-up. And so you're going to do three this way, three that way, and you're going to repeat that in a set of three. So you'll start with the modified plank, the one where you reach up and go like this. You'll do that one first, and then you'll do the V-sit where you reach all the way up, legs straight out, upper body up. And then you'll do the plank walk, and you'll do that one in a set of three. And once you're done that set of three, you'll start from the very beginning. It's just kind of a basic workout that you can do from your home, and that's pretty much it. I hope you guys enjoyed. Once again, I'm Cassidy Shandro. See you guys later.
You're watching Nate News Watch, the next generation of news.
Hi, I'm Allison Kendall. Do you ever wonder if horror movies are making you just a little bit violent? I'm here at a horror fanatic's home to find out if you become what you watch. Let's go.
Ah, so I didn't know you were coming this early.
It's actually quite late. Horror fanatic Tate Creasy has over 400 movies in his collection. This is why he calls himself a horror expert.
I think that when you watch a horror movie, you get scared because you see what is happening to people. And you don't often see yourself in the position of the killer or the ghost or the antagonist of the movie. And most people, when they sit there and they get scared, their first reaction is not, oh, let's go out and harm somebody. It's, hey, I'm scared and I'm going to go walk around the house with every single light on. Hello, I bet you're wondering why I all have gathered you here today. I would like to talk about the misrepresentation of our role in horror movies and how people think that we make other people violent. But don't we make other people violent? We sure do not.
When most people watch a horror movie, they don't see themselves in the position of the antagonist. They don't see themselves in the position of Jason or Freddy or the person harming the other people. They see themselves in the role of the protagonist or the main group of people.
Okay, I'm gonna go to bed now.
And there you have it. For second edition, I'm Allison Kendall.
Thank you, Allison, for that look into the mind of a horror fanatic. What an amazing first episode this has been.
It sure was, Tom. Thank you for joining us for our inaugural episode of second edition. This fall semester is shaping up to be a pretty exciting one.